Here in these serene North Pacific waters, it's hard to believe we're under invasion. Who are these unwelcome new inhabitants? The European green crab. Like other invasive species, green crabs leave a trail of destruction behind them, outcompeting native species and laying bare seagrass beds, which are critical habitat for Pacific herring and salmon. Off the coast of Vancouver Island, people are mobilizing to remove these crabs by the thousands, trying to stamp out new hotspots before the crabs establish footholds with the help of eDNA. But are they too late to stop this crustacean invasion? Join us as we crack the code on nature and unlock mysteries in The Nature Files. While it may seem unfair to paint a species as a villain just for being extraordinary at proliferating and spreading their kind, the green crab certainly makes a case for it. They're super successful predators, outcompeting native and commercially important species like Dungeness crabs and preying directly on young crabs and shore crabs. On top of that, they also burrow, digging up eelgrass beds, which juvenile salmon and a whole range of other creatures rely on.
European green crab are a threat to pretty much any native species that lives in the area because they're known as ecosystem engineers. So not only do they impact the other species that they're preying upon or outcompeting, but they have an impact on the ecosystem as a whole. They can take somewhere that could be a beautiful intertidal eelgrass bed and turn it into just mud.
Krista Stubbs and her team at the Coastal Restoration Society have been trapping green crabs in the Sooke Basin and Clackwat Sound since 2021 as part of a project funded by the BC Salmon Restoration and Innovation Fund and Fisheries and Oceans Canada. But it's mostly been an uphill battle.
Okay, so we're just pulling up to our first spot here. Oh my God. Holy, you gotta be kidding me. Krista, look at this. There's probably two or three dozen at least in here.
We were dropping up to 40 traps a day at the start, and we captured over 10,000 green crabs just in those 40 traps in one day. And there really is no way to describe how it feels to see a super sack full of green crabs craned off of the boat in the first couple weeks of a program, which really was a pilot project.
So how did this super species even get here? They first made their way to the east coast of North America around 1817 in the holds of wooden ships. Then, in the late 1980s, they cropped up in San Francisco Bay through aquaculture packaging. Over the last three decades, they've spread like wildfire up and down the coast. In 2022, they were even detected as far north as Alaska. They're especially good at spreading from place to place because their larval stage, when they're just wee plankton, lasts up to 80 days, allowing them to float with ocean currents for longer distances before settling down and establishing new populations.
With aquatic invasives in particular, you really want to catch them early and stop them before they invade. But we have so many self-sustaining populations at the moment that our goal isn't eradication, and I don't think we can expect to eradicate green crab, but I think what we need to do is look forward and see what we can do to control the populations to keep them at a level where our ecosystems can still act as normal.
So what can be done to stop such an invasive and destructive predator in its tracks? The Coastal Restoration Society has been working with indigenous communities like the Sooke Nation to train them to do their own early detection monitoring, identifying areas that are likely to have invasions of European green crab before the crabs establish a foothold. And now, they've got a new secret weapon to aid in the early detection monitoring, environmental DNA.
So when you go in the kit, you're gonna take out a few things, and as soon as you take them out, they become dirty. Upright
to fill. Today, with the help of Sue Velasquez from the Hakai Institute, they're going through eDNA training, learning how to collect water samples, which will pick up traces of green crab DNA if they're in the area, making it much easier to focus their trapping efforts on the right spots. The pilot project hopes to shed some light on how best to handle green crabs going forward.
So yeah, the importance of this work with Hakai and doing this eDNA is to really start a baseline of collecting this data you know, understanding how to use the eDNA in places that we know where there is large amounts of green crab present. We can study presence, obviously, but also the larval stages and how that's moving around the Salish Sea.
Using eDNA, they can also look at the impact on native species in the area and see how the ecosystem is reacting to the control program that traps European green crab en masse.
We feel really optimistic, and we're even seeing some differences in our eelgrass monitoring too, where we're seeing more bycatch, we're seeing larger density of eelgrass. So, you know, those traps aren't full to the brim anymore. You know, there's manageable numbers.
Despite years of an uphill struggle, the impacts of their removal efforts are starting to show, thanks to their cooperative all-hands-on-deck approach. Green crabs are likely here to stay, but with the help of environmental DNA, we stand a chance at getting ahead of their spread and preserving our ecosystems as we have come to know and love them. That's a case closed for the Colonizing Crabs, our last nature file. But join us next week for a Q&A with the folks behind the series, looking to the future of eDNA, which may bring us closer to the final frontier than ever before.